My name is Terry Covey, and I'm the pastor of Twin Oaks Baptist Church. This message that you are about to hear was delivered at Twin Oaks. We pray that it will be a blessing to you, and if there are any questions that you may have or any way that we may be of help to you, please feel free to contact us. God bless you, and have a great day. Take your Bibles and turn to the book of Ruth. There in the Old Testament, the book of Ruth. You find the book of Psalms. You kind of go back to your left a little ways. Ruth's about the, I think it's the sixth or seventh book in the Bible, somewhere there. I'm not sure exactly what, but the book of Ruth. This morning I want to talk with you about the providence of God, or following God in the providence, in His providence. Now, what is providence? You don't find that word in the Bible. Actually, it's one time. The word providence is used one time in the King James Version, but the principle of God's providence is found throughout Scripture. And providence simply means this. It means the foreseeing care and guidance of God. It means that God is down the road ahead of us, that God goes before us, that God knows what's going to occur in our life. He goes before us, and He works for us, and He provides for us, and He leads us. God doesn't send us out into things. God leads us into it, for God Himself is there with us, and He's leading us whatever the event might be in our life. If it's a good event, or even if it's a painful event. You remember when the Hebrew children were in the fiery furnace. The Bible says there was a fourth man there in the furnace with them, the Son of God. So God goes with us, and in His providence, God knows what is ahead of us in life, and God leads us. The Bible says this in the book of Psalms, "The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. Though he fail, he shall not utterly be cast down, for the Lord upholdeth him with his hand." Now, the Bible doesn't say that everything we do is necessarily in the will of God. It doesn't say the steps of every man's ordered by the Lord. It doesn't say that God instigates evil in the world or sin in the world. It says the steps of a good man. What that means is the steps of someone who's striving to follow after God, someone who's in the Word of God. He's a believer, first of all. He's in the Word of God. The Holy Spirit is within him, teaching him and guiding him. And that man or that woman, as they're listening to the voice of God, the Bible says that God is ordering the steps for that individual. God is leading them along through life. I believe very, very much in the providence of God. I believe that it was the hand of God that, and I don't know who it is that did it, I believe it was the hand of God that caused someone to invite my dad to church many, many years ago. You've heard me tell, he was the mailman, the mail carrier. And I don't know where it happened. I don't know if it happened on the mail route or where it happened in the store, something. But somebody in the community invited Melvin Covey to come to their church. And I don't know if that individual knew. We were going to a church, but we were not hearing the truth. We were not hearing the gospel. We were not saved. But we started going to this little Baptist church in the community. And in a short period of time, my dad, my mom, myself, my brother, we were all saved, baptized, became a member of that church. It was the providence of God that caused somebody to ask me to work in Bible school. I don't even know who was the superintendent of Bible school that year, but somebody got up enough, and I had, as a teenager, I had not really been following after God, and then I had come back to the Lord and started attending church. My life, God was turning my life around, and somebody said, "Would you help us in Bible school?" And when I don't know what to do, and they gave me that easy task of teaching teenagers in Bible school. We had a Bible school with teenagers that year. And so I taught the teenagers in Bible school that year and really enjoyed it. And then they said, "Well, would you this fall teach in the teen Sunday school class?" Well, okay, I guess. And then the pastor one time said, "Would you teach some night on a Wednesday night?" Well, okay, I'll try. And I had a tremendous message on the life of Joseph. And I delivered the whole lesson in about 3 or 4 minutes. I was so scared to death that night. And then I remember one night, my pastor, we've been working with the youth. We'd been somewhere on a Saturday night. We were coming back, and he said, "The opportunity has come up for our church to have a jail ministry every other week. What do you think about that?" And I said, "That'd be a good thing for you to do." He said, "No, I think it'd be a good thing for you to do." And so I started going to the local county jail every other Saturday. Whew, that was so hard. I was so. They would, every one of them had a television blaring wide open, and they would be listening to wrestling. Can you imagine trying to stand up and talk about Jesus? The guys in jail when they're watching wrestling. But God used me to win people to the Lord. It was the providence of God. I remember one time my pastor was going out of town, and he asked me to preach a message on Sunday morning. So I started praying about that, and my message was on Achan. There in the book of Joshua, my message was on Achan, and lo and behold, believe it or not, I preached that message, and people came forward that morning in church and rededicated their lives. And I got that taste in my mouth of serving God. I went to Tennessee Temple. Forgive me for telling all this, but I just love to think about all of it. I went to Tennessee Temple in Chattanooga. You know, we were raised in the New River Valley. The obvious place for me to go to school to prepare for the ministry is where? Liberty. But I never even once thought about Liberty. I had no desire whatsoever to go to Liberty. We went down to Piedmont Bible College and checked it out. Nah, that wasn't it. And then we, of course, there was a college in Florida. So we checked it out, but that wasn't it. And so I had a Christian magazine, Moody Monthly Magazine, and I was looking at that magazine one day, and it was a posed picture of a guy in a suit sitting outside reading his Bible. And when I saw that picture of that guy, I'd never heard of Tennessee Temple, but I thought, I want to go to Tennessee Temple. I asked my pastor, I said, is that a good school? He said, yeah, that'd be a good school. And so we went down there. The first time we went, Tammy and myself, and this guy came up to us, and he said, you look like a couple that's maybe considering coming to school this fall. And we was like, well, yeah. He said, why don't you come by? He was getting ready to graduate. He said, why don't you come by my house this afternoon and let us, his name was Darwin Marshall. I'll never forget Darwin Marshall. He invited us into his home, and he said, let me help you. He gave us some guidance. He helped us to find a place to live. Matter of fact, one time we went down to visit the school, and Darwin Marshall was out of town. And believe it or not, I'd only met this man one time and talked with him on the phone some, but he said, there'll be a key to my house under the doormat, and he says, you're welcome to stay in my house this weekend while we're gone. Tammy and I had never seen Christianity like that in our life. To be honest with you, it blew us away. So I went to Tennessee Temple. I tried to find a job in Tennessee Temple. I called every place in Chattanooga. I was a draftsman. Every place I could find that maybe to hire a draftsman. Nobody. One guy finally said, when you move here, when you get moved in, come and talk to me. And so I quit my job. We sold our house. We moved to Tennessee and moved into this old house, rented for a few weeks, week by week, until we could find a place to live. And I got all dressed up and went for that job interview. And you know something? I didn't need to have 50 interviews. I only need to have one. That guy hired me and paid me more money than he was paying the guy that he already had there. We moved to Lima, Ohio. I sent out resumes. Nowhere. I mean, there's resumes. It's got Terry Covey on it all over across the world. I guess, you know, nobody. I got so discouraged. I fussed at God. We were living in Lynchburg. I was going to the seminary. And one day, the Lord said, send out resumes again. So I got the list of Tennessee Temple churches looking for somebody. I sent all these resumes. There was a church in North Carolina. I thought, that'd be pretty good. It's warm in North Carolina. Let's move to North Carolina. I sent also, there was a resume there to Ohio. And I thought, I don't want to send that resume to Ohio, but okay, I'll send it there. And I'm at work. I went in 7 o'clock one morning, and it's 10 o'clock that night, and I'm still at work. And Tammy called me, and she said, there's a pastor in Lima, Ohio. I want you to call him tonight. It doesn't matter how late it is. He wants you to call him tonight. So I called him, and he said, can you come up this weekend? I said, well, yeah, I guess, sure. So we went up there. We candidated in the church. He said, can you come back next weekend? I said, well, yeah, okay. So we'll come. We went back the next weekend. They voted on us. We were there. I thought I'd be there 5 years. I was there for 11 years. We were looking for a house. We had picked out what house we wanted. We saw some houses we wanted to buy. And so we found this realtor. And she said, before I show you all these other houses, can I show you this one house? Well, yeah, okay.
So he showed us that one house. I thought, okay, you got that out of your system. Now, let's go look at the houses we want to look at. We were driving back. We were staying in Dayton, living with Tammy's dad at that time, and already working at the church, living out of the back of the car. We had boxes in the car that had our clothes segregated where you could out of dress out of the back of the car. Can you imagine going in and working at a church, had to wear a tie every day, and you're dressing out of the back of your car? But it's a miracle I'm still married. But anyhow, we did that. We were driving back to Tammy's dad, and we both looked at each other, and we said, what are we doing? We asked God to help us find a house. We can buy that house. That's in our price range. And so we bought that house, lived in that house for 11 years. The day I announced that I was leaving to come here, somebody came that night to my house and said, would you sell us your home? How much you want for it? Sold it. I never even put up a sign. When we moved to Chattanooga, I don't say this is going to happen, dude. When we moved to Chattanooga, I didn't even put up a sign. I didn't even have the house for sale. Somebody from Maryland called me and said, would you be willing to sell your house? Maybe. You know? I made them a price. I didn't even have it appraised. I just made a price what I thought I wanted for it. They paid it. They bought it. Tennessee Temple, both my daughters. Cindy didn't want to go to college after she got out of high school. She was with Encounter Revival Ministry for 2 years. The providence of God caused them to stop at Tennessee Temple one time, and the Lord said to her, you need to come to school here. So Cindy decided to go down to Tennessee Temple. And then Amy decided to go down to Tennessee Temple. They both graduated from Tennessee Temple. They both met their husbands at Tennessee Temple. Both of them are graduates of Tennessee Temple. I was in Ohio for 11 years. I'm almost done here. I was in Ohio for 11 years, and I wanted to pastor a church. And I sent out resumes. I've candidated in a lot of churches. I actually had one or two churches wanted us to come to that church, and we just didn't feel like that's what we should do. And so one day I was so discouraged, thinking that God is, you know, what's going on, God? And I got to Proclaimer magazine, which comes from the Southern Baptist. And God said, you need to check out their website. I thought, doesn't do any good. I've looked at it. God said, go to it. Trust me. So I went to that, checked it out, and I found this church in Farron, Virginia that was looking for praise and worship music, and young church. And okay, we'll give it a shot. Now I've been here for 11 years. And you know something? God works in every one of our lives in that way. The providence, I'm just telling you my story, but if you would step back and think about it, you could give the details of your life, and that is called the providence of God. That is God going before us, leading the way. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that everything's going to be a picnic. And all those now for us, it's been almost 30 years since we started that journey. And there's been a whole lot of discouraging times, been a whole lot of times of wondering what was going to happen. But God was with us in every step of the way. And in Ruth, the book of Ruth, last week we looked at chapter 1, verse 1. It came to pass in those days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. The man's name was Elimelech. The name of his wife was Naomi. You know the story. We studied it last week. They moved to Moab in order to find food. Then the two, verse 4, the two sons took them wives of the women of Moab. The name of one was Orpah, and the name of the other was Ruth. And they dwelled there about 10 years. But then the two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, died, both of them, and the woman was left of her two sons and her husband. So think what a tragedy that was. She's a widow, and she's got two daughters-in-law, and now both of those are widows as well. And Naomi became very discouraged. Matter of fact, verse 20, we studied it last week, when Naomi decided to return back to Bethlehem. Verse 19, so they went until they came to Bethlehem, and it came to pass when they were come to Bethlehem and all the city was moved about them, and they said, is this Naomi? She'd been gone for 10 years. Welcome back, Naomi. She said unto them, call me not Naomi, call me Mara, for the Almighty hath dealt very bitterly with me. The name Naomi means pleasant. The name Mara means bitter. She'd become very bitter. She thought that God was against her, but God was not against her. God was for her. God was working even through the tragedies. God works even through the tragedies. God was working and God was instigating the events because God had a plan that was much greater than Naomi or Elimelech or anyone else. And in verse 22 of chapter 1, so Naomi returned, and Ruth the Moabitess, her daughter-in-law, with her, which returned out of the country of Moab, and they came to Bethlehem. And notice what it says at the end of verse 22, in the beginning of the barley harvest. That's an insignificant thing, isn't it? No. That was God. God knows when and where and how, and God knows all the details of life. God knew. God wanted me to pastor a church sometime, but he knew when and he knew where. He knew how it would happen. God had a job for me in Chattanooga. He knew when and where. He knew how it would happen. He brought them at this opportune time at the beginning of the barley harvest. Verse 1 of chapter 2. And Naomi had a kinsman of her husband, a mighty man of wealth, in the family of Elimelech, and his name was Boaz. And Ruth the Moabitess said unto Naomi, let me go now to the field and glean ears of corn after him in whose sight I shall find. And she said to her, go, my daughter. Now let me stop there for a moment and explain to you. According to the book of Leviticus, when the nation of Israel, when they were doing their harvest, they were not to sweep the ground clean. As they were bringing in their harvest, they were not to reap in the corners of the field. And if they dropped any along the way, they were not to go back and pick it up. This was God's welfare program. It wasn't just a handout, but the poor then had the opportunity to go out into the field, and the poor people had the opportunity to glean the grain, whatever it would be in the corner of the field or anything that was dropped. And so Ruth, and the initiative that Ruth has, Ruth knows, she doesn't know what to do, she just knows to take the next step. She knows what the next step is. We need food, and I need to get out here, and I need to look for food. And so she said to Naomi, let me go out and find a field, somebody that will be gracious to me. Let me find a field where I can glean corn or grain for us. Verse 2, Naomi said, go, my daughter. And she went and came and gleaned in the field after the reapers. And her hap, and the word there means by chance, was to light on the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was of the kindred of Elimelech. That was a coincidence, wasn't it? That was not a coincidence. That was the hand of God. Now, I've often thought about this for Ruth, why she chose this particular field. Did she go to this one? She didn't know Boaz. She never even heard the name. She didn't know what chapters 3 and 4 were going to say. She's in the early part of chapter 2. She's just come out of chapter 1. Her husband's died. Her brother-in-law's died. Her father-in-law's dead. She's a widow. Her mother-in-law's a widow. It's a bleak situation. But she just knows, I need to take this next step. And I'll tell you something. God has been good to me in my life, but God did not give me a game plan in the very beginning and say, here's all that's going to happen. God did not do that. God just always told me, take the next step. Just be obedient. And let me tell you something, brethren. If we won't be obedient and take the next step, there's no need of God revealing the rest. God's will is not multiple choice. God's will is, here's what you need to do. Be obedient and do it. And I have learned that when I'm obedient and take the next step, whatever it is, God is always the next step ahead of me. He's always there. God's always going before me. He's always got a plan, and he had a plan for Ruth. Maybe Ruth said, this is the closest field to the house. Maybe Ruth thought, well, this is a field that doesn't have anyone else reaping in, and I can reap in it. I'll tell you why Ruth chose that field, because God had his hand on her shoulders guiding her. God was the one who steered her to this particular field because this was a part of God's will for her life. Why this particular field? Why is it important that Elimelech, the Bible already we've read twice, that Elimelech is a relative of Boaz? Some say, and I don't know this is for sure, some say that Elimelech was actually a brother. Boaz and Elimelech actually were physical brothers. I don't know if that's certain or sure, But I know that they were kin, and we'll study more about that next week, why that was so important. She couldn't, God didn't want her just to go to any field. God had the field. I saw a sign the other day, and I kind of agree with it, and I kind of don't agree with it. It was a church sign. You know, it says when God closes a door, he opens a window. And I kind of agree with that. Here's what I've discovered in my life. When God is closing the doors, the reason God is closing the doors is because he has the door. The door that he wants us to go through. It used to be when I felt like a door was closed to me that I got angry and I got frustrated and I kind of rebelled against God, which only made God have to chasten me until he could get me back to the point he could bless me again. But what I've learned in life, and I step back when the doors seem like they're closed to me, I step back from it and I realize that God is not closing these doors that because it's against me. God is opening the door. I used to tell people like this, being in the will of God. This is a silly illustration. You ever go bowling? You know, most of you, I'm sure you've been bowling. And so when you get there bowling, they won't let you wear your street shoes. You have to rent these shoes from them, and so you wear shoes somebody else has been wearing right before you, but you know, you go bowling in those shoes. But then if you ever, you go back and you turn in their shoes and they hand you back your shoes and you put your foot, you understand what I'm saying? You put your foot in, it's like, that's my shoes. That's when I know when I'm in the will of God. I'm putting on my shoes. And these are the shoes that God has ordained for me. So God leads her to this particular field of Boaz. Verse 4. Behold, Boaz came from Bethlehem. This happened to him that day that she was there. And he said unto the reapers, the Lord be with you. And they answered and said, the Lord bless thee. Then said Boaz unto the servant that was set over the reapers, whose damsel is this? Now, I don't know. Boaz had ladies out there working in the fields as well. So maybe the reason Boaz said that was because she doesn't work for me. Who is this? But I think that probably the reason he said that was what? You know, it's just like I saw this little blonde-headed gal one night, Sunday night in church. And as soon as I saw that little blonde-headed gal, I thought, that's the person I'm going to marry. And so probably, you know, God's stirring in the heart of Boaz. As far as we know, Boaz was never married. Verse 6, the servant that was set over the reapers answered and said, well, it's the Moabitish damsel that came back with Naomi out of the country of Moab. And she said to us, I pray you, let me go out and gather this as the poor, and gather after the reapers among the sheaves. So she came and hath continued even from morning until now, that she tarried only a little while in the house. Then said Boaz unto Ruth, hearken thou not, my daughter. Go not unto glean in another field, neither go from hence, but abide here fast by my maidens. Let thine eyes be on the field that they do reap, and go thou after them. Have I not charged the young men that they shall not touch thee? And when thou art athirst, go unto the vessels and drink of that which the young men have drawn. And she fell on her face and bowed herself to the ground and said unto him, why have I found grace in thine eyes that thou shouldest take knowledge of me, seeing I am a stranger? And Boaz answered and said unto her, it hath been fully showed me all that thou hast done unto thy mother-in-law since the death of thine husband. And thou hast left thy father and thy mother in the land of thy nativity, and are come unto a people which thou knewest not heretofore. Verse 12, notice, I got it underlined. The Lord recompense or reward thy work, and a full reward be given thee of the Lord, under whose wings thou art come to trust. I believe that God has a perfect plan for every one of our lives. I do. I believe that this plan, that God wants to bless us in this plan, and I believe that God wants to bring himself glory through this plan. One of the things I had to learn when I first went into the ministry is that I didn't need to be anybody else. I struggled with that at first. When I first moved to Ohio, I was in my mid-30s at that time, and I'd never, it was my first time in the ministry. I mean, I've been working since I was 16 on a public job, but first time I'd ever been called a pastor and step into a church. And the guy that was there before me, he had been there about 7 or 8 years. He had a Master of Divinity. What does that mean? That means he had 100 hours graduate work. That's about 3 times the average master's degree that you get anywhere else. That's what a Master of Divinity is. He had a Master of Divinity. He had been there 6 or 7 years. Everybody loved Jim and Jennifer. You know, I got Jim's office. I got Jim's scissors, had his name on them. I threw them away. Because I was so insecure. I was struggling so much with it. I was so insecure. Jim's was out of a multi-generational family that had been in ministry. I've got books in my office that Jim's grandfather wrote. And everybody loved Jim. And now I'm coming in there. You know? And one day, I was just beating myself up so much. I was so insecure in all of this, and I was beating myself up one day, and I went to visit this lady in a nursing home, and I was driving back down the road, and again, I was just kind of complaining, talking to God, you know, being very open and honest with God. And I'll never forget what God said to me that day. He said, "Terry, if I wanted things to stay the way they were, I would have left them the way they were. I wanted to change it. That's why I took Jim to Muncie, Indiana. By the way, I preached in Jim's church. I did a revival in his church. That's why I took Jim to Muncie, Indiana, and that's why I brought you here. I know who you are, Terry. I know what your strengths are. I know what your weaknesses are. And I chose you. So go for it. Just be yourself, Terry." And God, you don't know something? God blessed me in it. You don't have to be mean. You don't have to. I'm not you. But God has chose every one of us. God has given us life experiences. God has given us spiritual gifts. God has given us natural talents and abilities. And he wants to use each of us uniquely as who we are, because God's got a providential plan of going before us, how he wants to use us in life. I remember when I was in Ohio and Terry Smith was over the music ministry. Terry Smith's been here once before. Maybe some of you remember him. And, you know, people would want to sing a song sometime in church. And Terry, I remember he said that to me many, many times. Terry would say, he'd kind of go, he says, "They have such a good voice, but they're trying to sing that song exactly the way it's on the record." And he said, "That's the worst mistake they can make. They just need to sing it the way they are. Don't mimic somebody else. Just be themselves and sing it. Give the flavor to that song that they can give to that song." So God is calling Ruth. He knows who Ruth is. He knows who Boaz is. God has got a plan. God has orchestrated the events. Up to this point, as I've already said, they look pretty bleak. Ruth's husband's died. Boaz, as far as we know, Boaz is probably about the age of Naomi. He's old enough maybe to be her dad. And as far as we know, he's never been married. So what do you think Boaz has been thinking along through life? God is against me. I guess it's just meant for me to be this way in life. And probably Boaz, think about what an average day it was when Boaz decided on that day to get up and to go out to the field and just check, see what things. Had no idea. He had no idea that day that he was going to meet his wife, nor did Ruth have any idea she was going to meet her husband. You know, I've often thought about when Jesus sent his disciples to prepare the upper room, and he says, "You're going to find somebody carrying a pitcher of water and follow that individual to that house." And I've often thought about, wonder what caused them to carry that pitcher of water on that particular day. That's about as mundane a thing as you could possibly do, isn't it? No, not when God's in it. Not when the providential hand of God is orchestrating the events and you're following God. No day's an average day. No day's an insignificant day. No situation is insignificant. God is there orchestrating all the events in order to bring glory to himself. When I think about Boaz and the providence of God, I think about this. The providence of God caused Ruth to find a landowner. Boaz was a landowner. That was good. She needed the landowner. The Bible says he was a man of integrity and valor. He was a man who believed in God. He's a relative of hers. Not only that, Boaz is a man who has a famine in his own life. And God had been working in the life of Boaz up to this point. God had been working in the life of Ruth up to this point. He wanted to bring the two of them together so that they would eventually get married, and they'd have a son named Obed, and Obed would have a son named Jesse, and Jesse would have a son named David, and David would have a son named Jesus. That's the providential hand of God working. So what about us? Does God work in our life in that kind of way? I want you to turn with me to the book of Proverbs. You know this verse of Scripture. I could quote this verse of Scripture right now, and a lot of you would quote it along with me. Every time I say it in church, I watch, and a lot of your lips are moving as I say this, but I want you to read it from your Bible and maybe even put a little mark beside it, because you need to understand these two verses. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 says what? Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. What does it mean to trust in the Lord? If you are having a need today and you need somebody to help you, and I would come to you and I would say, listen, I will help you with that. I will take care of that. I will help you with that. If I would tell Donna had a great need today, and I'd say, Donna, trust me, I will take care of it. If Donna turned around and went to said, Steve, I just don't know what I'm going to do, would Donna be trusting me? If Donna was trusting me, Donna would say, I don't know exactly what's going to happen, but Pastor told me he'd take care of it, and I trust in him. The Bible says to trust in the Lord with all of your heart. In other words, let go of the control of it, and let God be God. And lean not unto thine own understanding, which means what? Stop trying to figure it out yourself. Stop trying to control it yourself. Every time I try to control something, I normally mess it up. Every time I try to play the Holy Spirit, it never works. The Holy Spirit is the Holy Spirit. God is God. I'm just a vessel that he uses. Trust in the Lord with all of thine heart. Lean not unto thine own understanding. Verse 6, what? In all thy ways acknowledge him. So that means what? It means to pray about it, and it needs to put God at the top of the list of whatever it is. And how many ways? The Bible says all of your ways. All your ways, acknowledge him, and he has promised to do what? To direct your paths. One of my favorite verses comes out of the book of Isaiah, and it says, thine ear shall hear a voice behind thee saying, this is the way, walk ye in it, when you turn to the right or when you turn to the left. You hear God. When you are walking with God, when you're in his word, when your life is clean before him, when you're listening to the Holy Spirit and you learn to walk with the Holy Spirit every day in your life. You can't live in rebellion against the Holy Spirit and hear the voice of God. You'll quench him and eventually you'll grieve him. You can't resist the Holy Spirit through the little things of life and then expect to hear him at the big time. You and I have got to learn to listen. And listening, I tell you what I've learned about listening to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit not only tells me what to do, often he tells me what not to do. As I preach messages, I not only pray what to say, I also pray, and Pastor Zach can verify this, I pray, Lord, keep me from saying what I shouldn't say. The Bible says when you learn to walk with God in that kind of way, he shall direct thy path. You might think it seems kind of shallow that I would make a decision where I was going to go to school by looking at a picture, a posed picture of a man. Scott McCurdy's his name. He's one of my good friends. Scott McCurdy was a man of God. He is a man of God. He was a seminary student at that time. And he and I became friends there at Tennessee Temple. But I knew I had that peace in my heart when I saw that. I knew. You know something? God doesn't shout out his will to us. He doesn't scream over the noise. The Bible says that God comes in a still, small whisper. He whispers to us. And when we learn to hear that whisper, then we can go through life with confidence. Each day is an adventure. With trust. Lo and behold, what God might have in store for us. The blessings that God might have in store for us. Boaz said to Ruth, he says, you've come to trust under God's wings. Does God have wings? God doesn't have wings. The Bible says God is a spirit and he's invisible. What does it mean to come to trust under God's wings? I looked up that phrase this past week. Shadow of his wings. I looked that up in the Bible to see. Can I just share you two or three of the blessings of resting under the shadow of God's wings? The Bible tells me that there is provision. It says in the book of Psalms, how excellent is thy loving kindness, O God. Therefore the children of men put their trust under the shadow of thy wings. They shall be abundantly satisfied with the fatness of thy house. Thou shalt make them drink of the rivers of thy pleasure. It's under God's wings where he provides what it is that we need. He talks about drinking from the river of his pleasure. It's under God's wings that we find the pleasure of life. It's under God's wings that we find pardon from our sins. But it's also under God's wings that we find the protection, knowing that we're in that place of safety. No matter what's going on around us, we're under the protection of God's wings. That day that I was struggling in Ohio, and I went up to Bluffton, which is up the road from Lima. I drove up the road that day to see a woman. Her name was Martha Burden. Martha Burden taught the fifth grade Sunday school class in our Christian school there at that church. And the Sunday school class that I taught to the young married couples, we met in that class on Sunday mornings. So Martha Burden and I kind of made an acquaintance. And Martha Burden had cancer. And when I first met Martha Burden, she was still teaching, but she was pretty much at the end of her tenure there to be able to teach in her cancer. And Martha Burden really, she needed people to minister to her. And I was so insecure that I needed somebody that really wanted me to minister to them. And so Martha Burden was old enough to be my mom, really. But Martha Burden and I became friends. And I would go and see Martha Burden a lot of time. And then Martha Burden finally had gone to this. She's in a hospital. Nursing home. She's in the hospital up in Bluffton, north of Lima. And so I went up to see Martha Burden that day. And Martha Burden had all of her fifth grade students memorize a chapter out of the Bible each year. Would you like to know what chapter she had them memorize? Psalm 91. Look at it with me. Let me read that and I'm done. Oh, if you were going to memorize a passage of Scripture, here's the passage of Scripture to memorize. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. Surely he will deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings thou shalt trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrows that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes thou shalt behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon. Thou shalt trample under feet, because he has set his love upon me. Therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he hath known my name. That's God speaking to us. He shall call upon me, God says, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Ruth really didn't know what to do. She didn't have all the plan. I don't even know how much she knew about God. Naomi tried to get her to go back home and go back to her gods. And Ruth said, no, thy God, Jehovah, shall be my God. And Ruth just set out in life this adventure, following God, the next step. God, Jehovah God, was her God, following God wherever he would lead her. You go to Matthew chapter 1 and you find out she was part of the ancestry, Jesus Christ. That's how good God is. When we let God be God.